Well, the last playoff game I'm going to talk about, of course, is game four of the series between the Utah Jazz and the LA Clippers. And the big news, of course, in this game was the return of Rudy Gobert for the Utah Jazz from the knee injury that he suffered just 15 seconds into game one. And he had a very solid game in just 24 minutes of play. 15 points on a perfect 6 of 6 shooting from the floor, along with 13 rebounds and 2 block shots. But unfortunately, they lost a player. The player that was the most dynamic player in Game 3, despite the loss that they suffered to the Clippers, Gordon Hayward, who, coming off a 40-point performance in Game 3, was suffering the effects of food poisoning and was limited to only 9 minutes of play. In 3 minutes, he was taking IV fluids throughout the day. And still, he had to be removed from the game because of the effects of the food poisoning. So they missed his contributions. What's up with the Utah Jazz and food poisoning in the playoffs, by the way? I think most people get that reference. What do I want to say about this game? The Clippers miss Blake Griffin. But this is the second year in a row that they've missed him in the postseason. Unlike last year, at least they still have Chris Paul. Chris Paul was sensational for the Clippers. 27 points, 9 rebounds, 12 assists, just 1 rebound shy of a triple-double. I think I saw up there that this is the 20th time in his career, no, the 25th time, excuse me, in his career that he's had a double-double. No, that's not exactly true. This is the 20th time in his career that he's had a game of at least 20 points and 10 rebounds among active players at second, on to LeBron James, who's done it 27 times, and Russell Westbrook has done it 20 times. But proportionally, I think Russell's a little bit more impressive because he's had significantly fewer playoff games than the other two, but I don't want to get into that debate. Oh, you're hating on LeBron. Oh, you're hating on Chris Paul. Oh, God. The Clippers. The Clippers generally, it was kind of a nip and tuck game most of the way. But later into the game, the Clippers nursed the lead. And, you know, the Utah Jazz were playing from behind. But the Clippers could never really create a lot of separation between themselves and the Jazz. And sort of reminds me a little bit of the Thunder and Rockets games sometimes where they're playing very well. Well, they weren't playing quite as well as the Thunder was, I guess, but they couldn't never create enough separation. At one point in time, I think after that Chris Paul three-pointer, that three-point attempt where he was fouled, I think it was pushed the lead to 87-80. But then Joe Johnson just took over the ball game. I think he scored like 13 points in the fourth quarter, had a game-high 28 points, ISO Joe. And he was responsible in one way, shape, or form for probably about 20 points in the fourth quarter, whether he scored or whether a double team led to an assist from him to various players. Other guy, what's his name? Ingles hit a couple of three-pointers off of a Joe Johnson assist. Joe Johnson had 28 points, 5 rebounds, and 5 assists. And Joe Johnson's stellar play helped to contribute to a 105-98 victory for the Utah Jazz. The series is now tied 2-2. And the scene shifts to L.A. for Game 5. I want to say this about Joe Johnson in conclusion. probably been well over a month ago now since I did that video where I was asking people whether or not you thought Joe Johnson was a Hall of Famer. And like I said, man, maybe more than 7% of people who commented said no. But these moments like this, and I said this before, remember, if you remember the video I did at the beginning of the playoffs, I said there's certain moments like these that people remember when they think whether or not you're a Hall of Famer. Because for years, when I thought of Joe Johnson, I thought of underachiever. I thought of overrated. I remember the years when he was Atlanta Hawks and he had that big $120 million contract, and I look at, you know, his production after he signed that contract, and I'm like, I'm not seeing it. I'm seeing a really good player, but superstar? Mm-mm. And if the reputation that he had as a guy who could put up some numbers, but it wasn't translating to him being part of a great team. I do remember him having a nice series against the Boston Celtics some years ago, the year they won the NBA championship, 2008 playoffs. I think that series went to 7, if I'm not mistaken. But other than that, I don't really remember a lot of great moments in the postseason for Joe Johnson. So, you know, prior to this series, prior to this year, if you asked me, was he a Hall of Famer, I would have told you an emphatic no. But the fact that he has scored over 20,000 career points, the fact that he's now creating some postseason memories, which is what I was telling guys, that's what you really remember. People can score 50 points against, you know, the Sacramento Kings or the Charlotte Hornets or, you know, the Minnesota Timberwolves. You know, you can get 55 against these guys, but people really remember the postseason. The postseason is where you can create moments that stay locked in people's minds. And even if you don't win a championship, if you go down as a guy who is known as one of the best clutch performers in NBA history, that in itself will create enough in people's minds that, yeah, this person should be a Hall of Famer. One of the best examples of that is, of course, Reggie Miller. Never won an NBA championship, but nobody could ever say that the Pacers didn't win because of him, that they weren't better off because of him. And Joe Johnson, in my mind, he's starting to change. I just heard Kenny Smith say this, too. I was going to say this in the video before I saw it. Joe Johnson's performances in his playoffs are starting to change my opinion of him. This is a guy who doesn't care about numbers. He cares about winning. Maybe we've all misjudged him. Maybe he wasn't scoring 30 points a game because he doesn't care about statistical achievement. He cares only about winning. Maybe when he was Atlanta Hawks, he didn't. And, you know, Atlanta, Phoenix, some of those years he was with Phoenix. Maybe, you know, he didn't have the team equipped to win. Now, will the Utah Jazz win a championship? I seriously doubt it. But this is a team that is, they wouldn't be in this position tied with the Clippers if it wasn't for Joe Johnson. Okay? Let's be clear about that. So that's it. The series is tied 2-2. Chris Paul had a magnificent game. Chris Paul, I'm starting to believe, is one of the most, if not the most underrated superstar in NBA history. I think if you asked me that question before, years ago, I would have said Moses Malone. I think Tim Duncan is unappreciated. But Chris Paul, I think when you consider what he's accomplished as an individual player, how dominant a point guard he was, especially in his prime, and he's still a very good player. But I think that He's the most unappreciated and underrated legend. Well, I think a better term is underappreciated. He's the most underappreciated NBA superstar I've ever seen in my life, bar none. But that's it. Tell me what you guys think about this series, which is going to happen.